Welcome back again. This is lecture number two. In this lecture, we'll focus on the pituitary gland hormones and their control by hormonal secretion by neurosecretory neurons within the hypothalamus. In other words, we'll talk mainly about which hypothalamic neurons control which hypothalamic hormone. And it's much easier than the previous one, and I'm sure you already have some background knowledge about this. Before I do this, remember the other time we said that there is a relation between the endocrine system and the hypothalamus, and the hypothalamus controls the endocrine system, and the endocrine system controls other glands, and thus the two systems work in a coordinated manner, both the endocrine and the nervous system, to regulate our and many of our body functions. And here we have three ways by which the nervous system or the hypothalamus controls the activity of our endocrine gland. The first one, or one of them is basically the hypothalamus secretory neuron releasing neurohormones or neuropeptides. These will be carried via the portal system, go to the pituitary, and cause the release of pituitary hormones. And the pituitary hormones will be carried via the blood to their target organ. The second way, in the hypothalamus, there are secretory neurons, neurosecretory neurons, that they send their axons to the posterior pituitary gland. These hormones synthesize and release a couple of hormones, oxytocin and ADH. They are stored here and they are released by the hypophyseal veins to their target tissue. And another one, the hypothalamus, through its effect on the sympathetic nervous system activity, when we are under stress, for example, it will activate, our sympathetic nervous system will be activated, and the sympathetic fibers will eventually terminate in the adrenal medulla and cause the secretion of norepinephrine and epinephrine. I'm gonna review the anatomy of the pituitary gland and its relation with the hypothalamus. This is the base of the hypothalamus, an area known as the median eminence. And there are several nuclei in the hypothalamus here, the medullary body, the optic chiasm, etc. And that's the connection, that's how the pituitary gland and the hypothalamus are connected, through the infundibulum or pituitary stalk, if you want to call it. And here are the loops of the pituitary gland. We have the anterior loop, or pars distalis. That's the one which is present in man. In other mammals, there might be an intermediate loop, but it's rudimentary in man. And then we have the posterior loop right here. The gland is located in the sphenoid bone in a structure known as the cella torsica. I'm sure you have studied this in the anatomy lecture. Now here, it is very important to realize what's the relation between the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland. The relation between the hypothalamus and the posterior pituitary gland is as follows. There are secretory neurons here that they will send axons, direct axons, to the pituitary gland, and they will form what's known as the hypothalamic hypophyseal tract. Okay? So it's a neuronal tract. Another way by which the hypothalamus is connected to the pituitary gland is through the portal system. And to understand this, let me just review the blood supply to both the anterior and the posterior pituitary gland. The posterior pituitary gland is simple. You have the inferior hypophyseal artery. It supplies the posterior pituitary gland. It forms a capillary plexus right here within the gland itself. And then blood will be drained by the posterior hypophyseal veins. Okay, now the arrangement or the circulatory arrangement or the blood supply to the posterior, to the anterior pituitary gland is significantly different here. Here is the superior hypophyseal artery, which is the major blood supply to the anterior pituitary. It does not go directly to the pituitary gland. It goes to the base of the hypothalamus here in the area known as the median eminence. It forms a capillary plexus or a primary plexus known as the primary plexus of the hypophyseal portal system. And then these capillaries will reunite to form another blood vessel known as the portal vessel or the portal vein or the hypothalamic hypophyseal portal vein. And this will carry the blood and form another capillary plexus or a secondary plexus located within the pituitary gland itself, known as the secondary plexus of the hypophyseal portal system. So you can see we have a major artery, a primary plexus, a portal vessel, and the secondary capillary plexus, and then the blood will be eventually drained through the hypophyseal veins, the anterior hypophyseal veins. This is a more simplified diagram showing again the relation between the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland. Let's start here with these red neurons. They are located in two nuclei known as, or nuclei, or in regions known as paraventricular nuclei and supraoptic nuclei. These are the cell bodies within the hypothalamus. The axons will travel down and they terminate within the posterior pituitary gland itself. So the hormone of these neurons or these secretory neurons will be synthesized here, carried via exoplasmic transport and secreted in the posterior pituitary gland. The posterior pituitary gland store them. They don't synthesize them. And once they are released, they are carried via the hypophyseal vein to their target destination. And this, if you go to this area right here and probably other areas within the hypothalamus, this, you see the pink neuron here, it goes. These are neurosecretory neurons. They synthesize and release tropic hormones. And these tropic hormones will secrete their axons after they travel from the cell body via the axon, via the axonal transport. And they are released within the primary plexus here and eventually will be carried to via the portal vessel to the anterior pituitary gland, and here is a secondary plexus here, and they affect the activity of the anterior pituitary gland. This is again shows you a more simplified diagram. These are the neurosecretory neurons. They secrete hormones into the primary plexus, which is located in the median eminence region. This is the primary capillary plexus right here. The secretion or the hormone secreted by these neurosecretory cells will be carried via the portal vein here or hypothalamic hypophyseal portal vessel, and then they will terminate in a second capillary, which is or sinuses within the anterior pituitary gland. They will affect the activity of the pituitary gland to secrete its own hormones, and the pituitary hormones will be carried by the hypophyseal vein to their target destination. It's now a more simplified diagram to show you the relation between the hypothalamic neurons and the posterior pituitary gland. These are the neurosecretory neurons within the hypothalamus, namely the paraventricular nucleus and the supraoptic nucleus. You can see these are the cell bodies here. They synthesize and make their hormones, oxytocin and ADH. These will travel through exoplasmic transport, and they will be released here within the posterior pituitary gland. Now you can see this is a neuronal tract, which we just called the hypothalamic hypophyseal tract. So both the hypothalamic and the hypophyseal tract, as well as the hypothalamic hypophyseal portal vessel, travel through the infundibulum or the pituitary stalk. This is a more simplified diagram, which basically shows you how hormonal regulation occurs between the hypothalamus and the pituitary. The hypothalamus releases neuropeptides. These neuropeptides could be releasing hormones, and They could be inhibitory hormones. Most of them are actually releasing hormones. They go to the pituitary gland through the portal vessel, increase the secretory activity of the pituitary gland cells, different types, and then the pituitary gland will release its tropic hormones and eventually reach its target gland or target tissue. Now here, the negative feedback is emphasized. When the hormone level is high, the hormone will go to the hypothalamus to suppress the release of the releasing hormones, or it could go to the pituitary gland and suppress the secretion of the pituitary gland. If we have another hormone from the hypothalamus which inhibits the secretion of the pituitary gland, when the hormone levels goes up, it goes to the hypothalamus and stimulate the release of the inhibitory hormone. And this occurs actually in the case of a growth hormone. Once the growth hormone levels are increased due to hypoglycemia or something else, it's gonna go to the hypothalamus, inhibit the release of the growth hormone, releasing hormone, and it will inhibit also the release of growth hormone from the pituitary gland. At the same time, the growth hormone will go to the hypothalamus and cause or stimulate the release of somatostatin, and somatostatin further suppresses the release of a growth hormone from the pituitary gland. This is just the feedback thing we talked about last lecture. Now, these are the hormones or the peptides that are secreted by the neurosecretory cells here. You can see we have thyrotropin-releasing hormone, gonadotropin-releasing hormone, corticotropin-releasing hormone, growth hormone-releasing hormone, somatostatin, and dopamine. All of these, four of them are excitatory, whereas somatostatin is inhibitory. It inhibits growth hormone secretion, and dopamine tonically inhibits prolactin secretion. Now, once these neurons secrete their content into the primary blood cells, here they will be carried by the portal vessel, they go to the cells of the pituitary gland, and depending which hormone is released, the pituitary gland will release a couple of hormones, TSH here and LH, when they are stimulated by GnRH, and the TSH and LH will go to the gonads, ovaries, and testes. FCRH is released from the hypothalamic neurons. It will stimulate the release of ACTH, and this will go to the adrenal cortex and mainly stimulate the release of glucocorticoids like cortisol. Now, TRH, thyrotropin-releasing hormone, cause the stimulation of TSH. TSH will go to the thyroid gland and stimulate the synthesis and the release of thyroid hormone, namely T3 and T4. Now, if you have GnRH released, it will go to the somatotropes in the anterior pituitary gland and it will release growth hormone. If dopamine is released, it will inhibit the prolactin secretion. So basically, prolactin secretion is inhibited. Once we need it, the hypothalamus stops releasing dopamine. And this is again a summary. This is the TRH. It goes to the thyrotropes, which constitute about 10% of the total population of cells. CRH, it goes to corticotropes. They constitute 10 to 25. GnRH, they go to gonadotropes, 10 to 15%. Growth hormone, releasing hormone, they go to somatotrophs. They constitute the majority of the cells within the anterior pituitary gland. And somatostatin also goes to these cells, but it inhibits the release of the growth hormone. Dopamine go to lactotrophs, inhibits the prolactin release, whereas at times when we have TRH elevated, it could stimulate prolactin secretion. So these are the hypothalamic trophic hormones, and these are the tropic hormones which are released by different types of cells in the pituitary gland. So these are the hypothalamic neurons, and these are the anterior pituitary hormones. This again, just the more, you know, I mean, there I just mentioned the abbreviations of the hormones. These are the names of the hormones, like thyrotropin stimulating hormone, TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, prolactin, growth hormone. So these are the pituitary hormone, and that's where their target gland or their final destination. And it just summarizes you step by step. Here we have the neurosecretory neuron. They synthesize the hormones here in the cell body to travel to the median eminence. The hormones are secreted into the hypophyseal portal capillary. They are carried via the portal vein or the portal vessel to the pituitary gland, and they are released into the venous blood, which drains the anterior pituitary gland. Okay, and then the anterior pituitary gland release its hormones, and these hormones will be carried to the blood via to their final destination. Again, this just summarizes what I said. So maybe you have to go to this table. TRH originates from the paraventricular nucleus, right there. It's a peptide, stimulates the secretion of TSH. TSH will go and stimulate the secretion of thyroid hormones. Then gonadotropin releasing hormones. The neurons originate in the arcuate nucleus. It's again a peptide, stimulate the secretion of FSH and LH by gonadotropes. These guys will go to the ovaries and the testes for reproductive functions. CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone, again is released by paraventricular nucleus. Growth hormone releasing hormone is released by the arcuate. Growth hormone inhibitory hormone, or somatostatin, is released by the anterior paraventricular nucleus. And the prolactin inhibitory hormone is released by the arcuate nucleus. So the hormones, most of the hormones are either secreted by the paraventricular nuclei or the arcuate nucleus. And these are their chemical nature. See, all of them, with the exception of dopamine, are peptide hormones. Dopamine is a tyrosine derivative or an amine derivative hormone. And this guy has inhibitory action. All of the pituitary gland, all the hypothalamic hormones are excitatory and increase the secretory activity of the pituitary gland, with the exception of these two, somatostatin and dopamine. These are inhibitory. And so you can read them. They are easy to follow, and if you have a question, you can raise it. Now we come, again, this is a nice schematic diagram which shows you the hypothalamic peptides, and the hypothalamic peptides will be released into the median eminence, carried via the portal system to the pituitary gland, and they affect the cells of the pituitary gland. And remember when we spoke about the mechanism of action of hormones, we focused or we emphasized that most of the peptide hormones act on surface receptors, and they bind with J protein coupled receptors. The J protein coupled receptors either stimulate, when they bind with the hormone, they couple them to enzymes within the membrane, either adenyl cyclase or phospholipase C. Adenyl cyclase will lead to the formation of adenyl cyclase, whereas phospholipase C will cause the formation of enstol triphosphate and diacylglycerol. So this summarizes the mechanism of action of hypothalamic hormones when they reach the anterior pituitary gland. If you take the thyrotropin releasing hormone to increase the secretory activity of thyrotrophs through the activation of the phospholipase system, okay, phospholipase C activity, and increase in stored triphosphate and diacylglycerol, and these will stimulate TSH. TSH, once it reaches the pituitary, it will bind with J protein coupled receptor and increase the synthesis of adenyl cyclase. If you go to GnRH, gonadotropin releasing hormone, they go to gonadotrophs in the pituitary through the phospholipase system again, and they increase the secretion of FSH and LH. Those will work in geoprotein coupled receptors and increase the activity of adenyl cyclase and stimulate the adenyl, the cyclic AMP second messenger system. The CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone, goes to corticotrophs. It acts through J coupled receptor and stimulate the cyclic AMP second messenger because it activates adenyl cyclase. Because the release of ACTH, ACTH, once it reaches the adrenal cortex again, it stimulates the adenyl cyclase and increase the adenyl cyclase activity and the formation or the activation of the cyclic AMP system. So GnRH also works through J protein coupled receptors and increase the activity of adenyl cyclase and activate the cyclic AMP second messenger system. And once it goes to its target organs, okay, in the tissue, this one does not go directly to a gland, it goes directly to a tissue. It works through the tyrosine kinase, it increases tyrosine kinase activity. Whereas somatostatin, it works through J protein coupled receptors, but it deactivates or inhibits the activity of adenyl cyclase and thus does not lead to the increase in the cyclic AMP second messenger system, and that's how it is inhibitory. And now remember, when we talked about the J protein, we spoke about inhibitory ones, GI and GS, stimulatory and inhibitory. Sometimes they are called alpha I and alpha S. And then we go to dopamine. Dopamine, apparently, because it's inhibitory, it acts through J protein coupled receptors, and it decreases the activity of adenyl cyclase. It decreases the activity of the entry of calcium ion, and that's how it suppresses prolactin release. And if prolactin is released when the tonic inhibition of dopamine is released, it goes to the mammary gland, and it works through the tyrosine kinase activity by increasing the activity of the tyrosine kinase, something we talked about in the last lecture. Actually, I just mentioned and talked about these hormones. Here is a summary of the anterior pituitary hormones and the cells. Corticotropes release ACTH, thyrotropes release TSH, gonadotropes release FSH and LH, mammotropes or lactotropes, they release prolactin, somatotropes, as the name implies, release a growth hormone, and somatotropin, sometimes it's called. So somatotropin or growth hormone, they refer to the same thing. This is the chemistry. You can see most of them are peptides, with the exception of prolactin and the growth hormone, they are proteins. And this is the physiological effect. We talked about that. For example, ACTH go to the adrenal cortex and stimulate the synthesis and the release mainly of glucocorticoids. It goes to a region known as the zona fasciculata. And it also goes to another region known as the nodular reticularis. You'll learn about it. And it stimulates the synthesis of cortisol and estrogens. And then we have thyrotrophs. TRH stimulates the thyroid to release its hormones, namely thyroxine T4 and T3, tetraiodothyronine and triiodothyronine, gonadotropes release FSH and LH. FSH is important for ovarian follicle and spermatogenesis. LH is important for ovulation and the formation and the development of corpus luteum during the luteal phase of the ovarian cycle. Growth prolactin, it goes to the mammary gland and it produces milk synthesis or essential for milk synthesis in lactating mothers. Somatotropes release growth hormone, goes almost to every tissue. It goes body growth to stimulate it has effects on metabolism, it has effects in elongation of bone, enlargement of visceral tissue, and we'll talk about this. Now let me just mention something about promyelinocortin. This is one family of hormones. The precursor of this hormone is a large protein, and it is synthesized in the hypothalamus here, in the arcuate nucleus, if I could remember. If you are stressed or something, or if it's too early in the morning, CRH will be released. It goes to the pituitary gland, and the pituitary gland will in response to CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone, the corticotrophs will synthesize the promyelinocortin. It's a large protein, it's a precursor, and then during, you know, the processing, they split. There are some endopeptidases there, and then they split to two main fragments, the ACTH fragment, and this stimulates the release of cortisol. And it also has another fragment, which is known as the beta-lipoprotein. The beta-lipoprotein will give two other hormones, mainly endorphins, and beta-melanocyte-stimulating hormone. Now, ACTH also has another fragment associated with it. It has also melanocyte hormone activity, but it's known as alpha-melanocyte. And let me show you what I mean by this. If you look at this slide, this is the large molecule, promyelinocortin, by peptidases to produce two main fragments, beta-lipoprotein and ACTH intermediate. And these are the two only components that are released in humans. This guy splits into beta endorphins and alpha lipoprotein. And this guy, when it is secreted, split further to ACTH and the fragment. This fragment here is the one which contains alpha melanocyte stimulating activity. Alpha melanocyte is probably more important in other mammals. In a human, it's there, and ACTH itself also has melanocyte, alpha melanocyte effect like, and these apparently go to the melanocyte and cause, they have something to do with the color of the skin and the pigmentation of the skin. Here it is, the alpha melanocyte stimulating hormone. It's by cleavage of proteins, proteolytic cleavage of promyelinocortin. It's mainly in the pars intermedia of the pituitary gland, which is probably developed in other animals, but not in man. Small amounts are produced in the human under normal condition. It exerts its effect through one type of receptors in the melanocytes known as melanocortin receptors. And the reason I'm saying this, because actually pigmentation changes occurs when we have hypersecretion of ACTH, okay? And if you have hypopituitarism, your color skin will change, or the color of your skin will look, it looks a little bit less dark or paler. Whereas, for example, if you have excessive amount of ACTH secreted, then there is hyperpigmentation. And this occurs actually in adrenal insufficiency, because in adrenal insufficiency or Addison disease, the gland fails to release cortisol. And as a result of this, the feedback inhibitory effect of cortisol in the anterior pituitary gland will be lost, and the pituitary gland will over-secrete ACTH. And since the secretion of ACTH is, since once ACTH secreted, a small fragment is also released along with ACTH, and it has alpha-melanocyte activity, ACTH by itself has slight alpha-melanocyte activity. But when it is excessively released, it causes hyperpigmentation of the skin. The melanocortin receptor, they mediate the effect of different peptides which are derived from the promyomelanocortin, including the skin, adrenal steroid, as they might be involved in thermal regulation. And they have been implicated actually in feed behavior and appetite regulation. I don't know if you have studied food intake regulation, but definitely melanocortin receptor have been or are known actually to mediate some effects of some factors or hormones which are related to the control of food intake. The beta endorphins, which is another component of the promyomelanocortin, these are known as endogenous opioid peptides. And actually, the physiological effects of beta endorphin is amazing. I mean, they have their own receptors known as opioid receptors, and they act in the periphery, and they act also in the nervous system. They are involved in so many things, like, you know, euphoria and things like that, the behavioral effects. And they have important role in the control of analgesia. Once we are exposed to pain, these beta endorphins are released and suppress the transmission of pain signal at the level of the spinal cord. You will learn about what's known as the brain analgesic system, one of the important transmitters released by neurons that suppress the transmission of brain signal through the brain analgesic system is the beta endorphins. You will learn more about it later. How to evaluate pituitary gland? We touched on this. For example, we can measure anterior pituitary hormones as well as the hormones released by the peripheral gland associated with this anterior pituitary hormone. For example, to evaluate thyroid function, we measure TSH and we measure T3 and T4. If we want to evaluate, for example, gonadal functions in the female, we can measure FSH and estradiol or beta estradiol. If we want to measure abnormalities in the adrenal cortex gland function, we measure ACTH as well as cortisol or glucocorticoids. Okay, and we talked about inhibition, stimulation, and suppression tests can be used in different conditions. Maybe you can revisit them. And I want to remind you that these suppression and stimulating tests are basically based on the physiological big fat mechanisms that tropic hormones release. And then I gave you a couple of examples last time, like if you infuse arginine, arginine will stimulate growth hormone in patients with suspected growth hormone deficiency. In acromegaly, we can measure growth hormone, and we can sometimes to see the growth hormone reserve by infusion of glucose, because one of the major stimuli is for growth hormone is hyperglycemia. So if you want to suppress the growth hormone secretion, you're giving glucose. If you want to stimulate growth hormone secretion, you give arginine. And then I talked about the suppression test in Cushing syndrome or in Cushing disease. And as I said, We have different tests. We have a low, high test, etc. And so we have the dexamethasone test. And I spoke last time about the low dose. So we are revisiting what we have said in the previous lecture. See, that's the thing. We build up. We build up on things we have learned. Now we go to the, you know, just to give you a highlight of the pituitary abnormalities or pituitary disorders. Pituitary hypersecretion, the most common is pituitary adenoma, usually benign neoplasm. Prolactinoma, which are tumors or adenomas that cause excessive release of prolactin, are the most common. GI secreting tumor. Okay, these are associated in the adult with acromegaly, and we'll talk about this, and gigantism in children. We have ACTH secreting tumors or adenomas, and these will cause Cushing disease. And you know, I don't want to talk about the clinical presentation because you will you will learn about this when you study the adrenal gland, but they present to the obesity, myopathies, hypertension, hyperglycemia, hyperpigmentation, etc. Gonadotropin pituitary tumors are frequently insufficient in hormone production, so they are not that important in causing abnormalities in our reproductive function. Thyrotropin releasing tumors are rare and are frequently large when diagnosed. يعني even with measurement, it's very hard to diagnose them. Now let's go to some highlights of hypopituitarism. It could be acquired or congenital. Acquired is can be caused by head trauma, surgery, injuries somewhere in the pituitary gland for one reason or the other. Or it could be caused by a benign tumor, which is a very rare. And the origin of this tumor is from the pituitary gland embryonic tissue. And it mostly occurs in children between the age of 15 and 14 years. And it occurs in the adult between the age of 50, 74 years old. You will learn more about this when you study the pathology. Or it occurs sometimes following delivery, where there might be ischemia due to thrombosis or something, and this ischemia causes pituitary infarction during the peripartum period, and this is what's known as Sheehan syndrome. Again, you will learn about it. The thing is, when you have hypopituitarism, whether it's acquired or congenital, the activity of the other glands, which are activated by the pituitary gland, will be suppressed, like the thyroid, adrenal cortex, the gonads, etc., etc. So if you are an adult, and God forbid, and you have panhypopituitarism, you will end up with hypothyroidism, adrenal insufficiency, hypogonadism, like amenorrhea in women. Adult women, it could cause loss of lactation in lactating mothers. It could cause growth hormone deficiency, and you know, you may have some problems with glycemic control. And in children, you will have all of the above. You will have hypopituitarism, adrenal insufficiency, and you will end up with retarded growth, something we'll talk about, known as dwarfism. And if it occurs before puberty, you know, I mean, it's also gonna lead to sexual immaturity. So